174, faith is the victory. 174, faith is the victory. And stand to your feet as we get ready to sing that song. 174. And when you rise to your feet, you need to have one hand free so we can do something that they should do every day in public schools. I don't know if they do anymore. It depends where it's at.
They don't do it.
Sometimes?
Really?
Okay. All right. I'm going to need one of the kids to come on up here. Be a volunteer. Daisy, come on up. I saw your hand first. Let's have you take it all the way out there towards the keyboard. And I'll hold it. There we go. Good. Can you raise it any higher? There you go. All right, ready? One, two, three.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right.
Amen.
Thank you. All right. Faith is the victory, 174. Here we go. Encampled on the hills of mighty Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foe in veils below, let all our strength be hurled. Faith is the victory we know. We're kind of be preaching on that a little bit today. Faith of our founding fathers and our Christian fathers. All right. Faith of our fathers. 165. Faith of our fathers living still in spite of dungeon fire. Say, faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. A little easier said than done.
Yeah.
I don't think we take these songs as seriously, and that's why modern Christianity wants songs just like this out of our hymnal.
That's right.
Amen.
We're going to sing it anyways, and with God's help through the Holy Spirit, like Brother Steve was talking about in Sunday school today, we'll be able to actually apply it to our life.
Amen.
Yes. Yes.
Our Father's chained in prison's dark. We're still in heart and conscience free. How sweet would be their children's faith if they like them could die.
Precursor, forewarning, 131.
What?
And no, we're not going to do it like we're at the football stadium. We're going to sing it like we're in church.
Oh.
Amen.
Yes.
I'm so sick of performances. This song has been overperformed and very little sung from the heart. The Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleam, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we so gallantly streamed, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, it proved through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner
second verse, let's give it a try, right?
Oh,
chapter 3, verses 15 through 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 15 through 17. And when you're there, go ahead and stand. All right, 2 Corinthians 3:15 through 17 says this. I guess I better turn myself on here and see if you can hear me all right. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. 2 Corinthians 3:15 through 17. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Speaking of the nation of Israel, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. All right, let's go ahead and open in prayer. Brother Zach, will you pray for the blessing over the sermon?
Yes. Dear Father, Lord, thank you so much for today. Lord, thank you so much for this great country that we're all able to be able to live in and be able to worship you freely, Lord. As long as we have that, Lord, we're very grateful. And Lord, I just pray that you would be with everybody today, help their minds and hearts be open for the message, Lord, and be with John as he delivers it, Lord Jesus. We want to ask you all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Okay, go ahead and be seated, everyone. And today's message is called Tree of Liberty. Tree of Liberty. And we're going to start here just by commenting a little bit on this verse 15. But even unto this day when Moses has read, the veil is upon their heart. A veil is something that hides things from your eyes that you cannot see. The veil has been taken off our eyes in order for us to be saved. The Bible says, God hath blinded the eyes of them that they should not believe. And basically, according to Brother Steve's testimony this morning, a story about climbing up 3 hours up a hill and then finding a road that would take them down, what was it, 15 minutes down, the veil may have been over his eyes. And some of the veil sometimes is on our eyes on purpose because God wants to hold something away from us until it's time.
Yeah.
The veil was taken, the veil is still on Israel's eyes when it comes to Jesus being their Messiah. And the veil, up until last week, was still over the Democrats' eyes when it came time for Joe Biden's mental capacity. And then finally, they came to, whoa, this guy is in bad shape.
Yeah.
We've been telling you that for 4 years, but, you know, the veil finally taken off. Since the veil has been taken off our eyes, we have what is called liberty. And the tree of liberty. I'm going to write that up here. There is a difference today, and I want to push the emphasis here, on the difference between liberty and freedom. I know that people love freedom, but not too many people talk about liberty. Liberty, right here, is not freedom. They are two different things. Liberty comes from God. By permission or grant. Freedom can just be something that somebody has. It doesn't have to come from anything, but I will say this, freedom usually comes from government. Freedom is something that the government allows people. Liberty is what God has allowed somebody to have. There's a big difference. Who is your daddy today? Is it going to be God or is it going to be government? You got to make sure that it's God. Turn to 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. And you'll notice that the Bible says that let liberty be proclaimed throughout all the land. This is something that everybody needs to know. You see, this has limits. This does not. And I wasn't going to go here yet. I won't go completely here yet. But freedom is connected with democracy. Liberty is connected with a republic. And I'll explain that more later. So, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 2, it says here, I exhort, therefore, that first of all supplications... Let me start over. I exhort, therefore, that first of all... First of all, you ever hear politicians say that? First of all... I think Joe Biden's favorite phrase during the debate was, the idea. The idea. Anybody remember hearing him say that? Everything Trump said, the idea that, the idea that... Well, anyways, must have been the only idea he had. But 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 through 2, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. But for who particularly? It says here, for kings. For all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. We need to be praying, first of all, for kings and for all that are in authority. Now, we don't have a king in America, at least I don't think, but we have presidents, and we have governors, and it's usually the people that we spend most of our dinner time meal complaining about. Amen? And we spend most of our time complaining about those people, but we need to pray for those people. Even if they are gone, even if they are not spiritually inclined to do what is right and what is wrong, the Holy Spirit can still work on those individuals to make plans, to make laws, to give us more liberty so that we can lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. We need to be praying that we, as Christians, have the right granted to us. I know that we have the liberty to win souls. We have the liberty to live right. We have the liberty to take our Bible wherever in the world we want. It doesn't matter whether the government allows us to. You see, the government may not have granted us the freedom to pray in public schools. The government may not have given us the freedom to read the Bible in public schools, but we have the liberty to do it because that right came from God. And the right came from a republic which is based upon a constitution. All right. The first things we pray for are kings and those that are in authority over us. How much time do you spend praying for your sheriffs? How much time do you spend praying for your deputies, for your pastor, for your teachers, for your mayors, for your council board members? How much time do you spend praying for them? How much time do you spend praying for the highway patrolmen that are out there? How much time do we spend praying for the policemen? Unfortunately, and here's the truth of it, if you're under liberty and you're focusing on the God-given rights that you have, you will be thinking and uplifting and praying for the police officers, the sheriffs, all those law enforcement officers. But if you're focusing on government and freedom, you will despise those that are in authority over you. I go into the jail yesterday morning, and just like clockwork, the new guy that came in, he called himself a fictitious name, very funny. But anyways, he said, yeah, we're in here and we're innocent. I said, I've heard that before. I've heard that before. You are innocent. I have heard that before. All of you are innocent. You ever watch Count of Monte Cristo with Jim Caviezel?
Yeah.
He goes into that Chateau d'If and the guy says, I know that you're innocent. Everybody in here is innocent. That's what they all say. Granted, in his case, he was. But most of those people are not innocent. You know, you go to jail for something. But anyways, our job is not to disparage our police officers and pastors. You see, it's the spirit of the age when we are not submitting ourselves, very much like Brother Steve's Sunday school, where he's talking about how if we go based upon what we want for so long, then eventually it's always the pastor's fault.
Yep.
It's always the sheriff's fault. It's always the policeman's fault. It's always those horrible teachers' fault. It's always the mayor's fault. It's the president's fault. It's the governor's fault. But it's never ours. Never ours. All right. I want to go ahead and read to you this very interesting thing that I got out of this book here. Hopefully I brought it. Okay, the role of pastors and Christians in civil government. And as I pull it out, the page comes out. But I got it right. The role of pastors and Christians in civil government. This might be surprising to you. This was interesting to me. In fact, signers of the Constitution, George Washington and Alexander Hamilton, acknowledged that the principle undergirding the separation of powers was the same principle found in Jeremiah 17:9, a principle that had been the subject of numerous sermons during the founding era. Do any of you remember what Jeremiah 17:9 says? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Freedom is connected with do whatever your heart tells you to do. And liberty tells you go with what God tells you to do. You've got to have a constitution. You've got to have the word of God. You've got to have both. Those are our two. In fact, if there's three things that we as American Christians need, we need the Bible, we need a hymn book, and we need the constitution. If we have those three things, we're going to be pretty good, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Many other Bible verses and principles also found embodiment in the constitution. For example, compare the Article 1, Section 8 provision on uniform immigration laws. Boy, you got to think about that. With Leviticus 19:34, compare the Article 2, Section 1 provision that a president must be a natural-born citizen with Deuteronomy 17:15. The Article 3, Section 3 provision regarding witnesses and capital punishment with Deuteronomy 17:6. And the Article 3, Section 3 provision against attainder with Ezekiel 18:20. And notice that Isaiah 33:22 defines the three branches of government. That's Isaiah 33:22. And Ezra 7:24 establishes the type of tax exemptions that the founders gave to our churches that still exist today. The concept of republicanism set forth in Article 4, Section 4, that is of electing our leaders at the local, country, county, state, and federal levels, has its origins in Exodus 18:21. All right. All of the, and there's so many more, but those are the things that are found in the scripture that the founders had the Bible open before them when they were writing the Constitution. And they said, hey, let's do this, what it says in Isaiah, and let's put this in our Constitution. But people are too infatuated with the godless Constitution, all these articles to try to make it look as though we serve and have a godless Constitution, an irreligious Constitution, just because it doesn't have the name God in it. I tell you what, you don't have to have the name God in your constitution in order for it to be a spiritual document.
Amen.
It is a political document. It doesn't have to have spiritual words in there, but it has spiritual principles in it.
Yeah.
Okay, Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Galatians 5, verse 1. Says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free. All of you in here today have freedom. You're all free. But are you standing fast in the liberty that made you free in the first place? Liberty says you have the right to do right. Go and do right, but you're under law. And if you don't do right, you'll get punished. Freedom doesn't talk about punishment. Freedom is what's driving this world right now. Freedom, not to do right, but freedom to promote prostitution. Freedom to promote illicit drugs. Freedom to make everything legal that shouldn't be legal. Freedom. In fact, if you, let's be honest, this is the framework for the Independent Party. More and more people are turning away from the Republican Party and going over to the Democratic Party or the Liberal Party because they want to, they're all for the legalization of everything. Why? I don't have my wallet on me. But if you pull it out, there's something in there that's green. You know what I'm saying? If prostitution is legal, you can tax it. If marijuana is legal, you can tax it. The love, thank you. Can I keep this?
No,
we should not steal.
We should not be focusing. If the reason for you legalizing something is so you can make more money, God forbid, you're in the wrong boat. We need to be focusing on the morality of the country rather than what is financially expedient. Now look at Galatians 5, verse 1. Stand therefore fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. I've already told you this is a politically incorrect church, so we're going to really have fun today. The Democratic Party is very good at trying to push us to idolize Denmark, Sweden, Great Britain, and all these other socialistically impacted governments, as though they are the precipice that we need to get to. No. The United States is the precipice, or was the precipice, for which we should always attain to, because it has a good foundation. This one does not have a good foundation. Democracy, all of those other foreign countries are not what we should be striving after. For instance, we got freedom from Great Britain. Why should we go back to it? Why should we learn to go back? And it's exactly the lessons that we learn in Exodus. We are just like the Israelites that were so stupid in the wilderness. Can you imagine seeing the Red Sea cross, the Red Sea completely open up to where you can see, wow, oh my goodness, is that that's a shark in there, you know what I'm saying? There's a big, huge fish in there, and I can see it right beside me as I'm walking through, you know, and you're seeing water over here. You know that God's opening it up for you, and then you see the Egyptians come through with their chariots. Oh boy, we're going to die. Moses lifts up his rod, and the waters come down and kill all the Egyptians. They're singing the song of Moses. Life is great. Life is peachy. 3 days later, why are we in this wilderness? That must mean we should go back to Egypt, where everything was great. Egypt is a type of the world. We don't need to go back to Great Britain to learn our lessons. We need to get back to the King James Bible to learn our lessons.
Amen.
We need to get back to the founders and learn our lessons. Don't you realize, kids, that's why you're not taught to learn cursive? The reason you're never going to learn cursive is because the government and the educational system does not want you to have the ability to read what the founding fathers wrote. So they can tell you, separation of church and state. The founders were anti-religious. Well, you're going to find out here in a second they were not. The yoke of bondage. Politically, all the leftists and Democrats seem to be praising, like I said, all these other countries as something that we should emulate, and they keep telling us to be afraid of losing our democracy. Again, at the risk of beating a dead horse. Kind of like, I'm just going to say it, I heard somebody say, we finally witnessed the beating of a dead corpse last week in a debate, and I thought, yikes. Well, that's kind of true, you know? They keep telling us to be afraid of losing our democracy, and I'll admit, there was part of that debate where I was actually feeling sorry for the guy. I was actually literally feeling sorry for the guy, even though I disagree with everything he stands for. But then I realized, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Yes. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. They keep telling us to not be afraid, to be afraid of losing our democracy. Again, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, one nation under God, under God, under God. That's okay as long as it's not the God of the Bible. This is where I'm getting with this. The freedom, people want freedom today. You know why? And I told this to the people in the jail yesterday morning. If you all decide, and you're the majority, and let's suppose that you weren't Christians, but you all decided as a majority, the majority rules, that's democracy, the majority rules, Christians should not be allowed to live. We should promote the capital punishment for Christians. under a democratic form of government where the majority rules, the majority would rule and the Christians would die.
Yep.
Under liberty, that won't happen. Why? Because of our Constitution.
That's right.
And our Bill of Rights that tell us what we can and can't do. That is why I am not afraid of losing democracy. The founders hated democracy. They loved republic. And they all said that. Okay? Don't listen to the news media. I'm here as a Bible-believing Christian to tell you that almost everything that you hear on the news is a bunch of garbage.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
The best way to figure out what the truth is to read the Bible, get into those old history books, and let me show you this. This is a good one. Did I bring it? I might not have. I don't think I did. Yes, I did. Aha, I got it right here. You know what? You can get this, and this is very cheap. This is the very first public school textbook in America. The New England Primer. Improved for the more easy attaining the true reading of English, to which is added the Assembly of Divines and Mr. Cotton's Catechism. Boston, 1777. When they taught people to read the alphabet, the kids, you know what they used for the alphabet? I'll read it to you. Just a couple. Just a couple. A. In Adam's fall, we sinned all. B. Heaven defined, the Bible mind. C. Christ crucified, for sinners died. D. The deluge drowned the earth around. E. Elijah hid, the ravens fed. And every single letter in the English alphabet is represented in your first public school textbook paid for by Congress. And it's all Bible. Every single one of them. So don't you dare let the public schools tell you that our founding documents were not religious or that our founders didn't want the Bible in schools. They had it emphatically. I mean, feel free to look at it. All right. Now look at Galatians 5:13. Galatians 5:13, it says here, for brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. You have been called unto liberty. Remember Jesus said, I came to proclaim liberty to the captives? He didn't come to proclaim freedom to the captives. He came to proclaim liberty to the captives. Why, we have a very special bell in America. You know what it's called? It's not called the Freedom Bell. It's called the Liberty Bell for a reason. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. Use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh. Instead, by love serve one another. Christians, it's not the pursuit of riches that will make America great again. It's the pursuit of obeying the two commandments Jesus Christ gave us, which is, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. Number two, love your neighbor as yourself. We must love God with everything we have, and then we have to love our neighbors in this country with truth and consideration, meekness, and sometimes a swift kick.
Yep.
Amen?
Yeah.
I don't mean a literal kick. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that. But you know, some of our people, they have what? They have the veil over their eyes.
Yeah.
I can't see it, Pastor. I know you can't. That's the veil off. You know, people can't find Jesus Christ for the same reason a thief can't find a policeman.
Yeah.
What purpose would a thief have in finding a policeman? They're going to go to jail. Why would they want to find a policeman? Why do you want to find Jesus if you're lost? But if you come to him, he will bless you, and he will save you. Okay. As a Christian, spiritually, use not the liberty that God has given you, and waste your time making your flesh happy. Don't waste your time making your flesh happy. Have a long view, and think about what's best for your future, because whatever you do today will reap consequences, good and bad, tomorrow. That is another reason why I don't fall under this tree, because all these people think of is today. You know what people under liberty think about? They think about tomorrow. In fact, Jesus teaches you the principle of if you're going to build something, do the work on paper and figure out what you're going to do before you start doing it. You got to think about tomorrow before it happens. But this setup right here, eat and drink, right? Today, let's eat and drink. Let's be merry, for tomorrow we shall die. Exactly. That's the whole Democratic Party premise. Let's do what we want to do today. Let's legalize abortion. Let's go ahead and kill the babies. Let's just go ahead and do it. Why? Because we're infringing on the women's right. To what? Kill? To do murder? What right does the baby have?
Yes.
It's all about today. As this form, it's all about today. What makes us happy today? Let's do it. If it feels good, do it. But over here, you realize, oh no, prolonged satisfaction. And we'll have a better tomorrow.
Yeah.
Let's not eat the cake and the pie and the ice cream and the gigantic meal today. Let's save some of it for tomorrow.
Yeah.
Tomorrow. All right? Think about what's best for your future, because whatever you do today will reap consequences, good and bad, tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Now, I am going to go ahead and read this to you. This is a great book, by the way, if you ever get a chance to read it. Original Intent by David Barton. Very good. And I'm just going to read to you some quotes from our founding fathers for you to see how far we have slipped. The Tree of Liberty. Representative quotes of many founders demonstrate their preference for Christianity and provide no evidence of any alleged mandate to promote a visible pluralistic society. Notice, George Washington said this, quote, by the way, he's writing this to Native Americans. You do well to wish to learn our arts and ways of life, and above all, the religion of Jesus Christ. Congress will do everything they can to assist you in this wise intention. But you can't do that, George. Separation of church and state. By the way, let me clarify that really quick. Separation of church and state. Because you're going to hear that. I'm a Baptist, and I believe in separation of church and state. But what I believe about that is not what the liberals believe.
Right.
Let me just get back to that really quick. Let me write it for you. Separation of church and state. Now, here's a little pop quiz for you. Is this the church?
No.
No, what is it?
Bible.
The Bible. Okay, very good. You know that. Most liberals don't know that. Church means denomination. For instance, when the founders came to their constitution, and right before the Americans went into war toward the battle for our independence, there were several states that had a state religion. Several states had state religions. One of them was Catholic, one of them was Quakers, one of them was Presbyterians and Episcopalians. But guess who didn't want the whole country to be one religion? It was the Baptists. They were the most scared of it. And so the Baptists, that's why, this is so you can learn, right? The Danbury Baptists were the ones that Thomas Jefferson was writing, where Thomas Jefferson told the Baptists, I understand your concern about separation of church and state, and yes, there is a wall between them. But this wall does not mean that there is no church, there's nothing spiritual within the state. What separation of church and state means, what this means is that there is no church, Episcopalian, Methodist, Baptist, whatever it is. There's no church that can then take over the state and tell us what we have to believe and how we have to practice our religion before God, or otherwise we'll face criminal prosecution. Does that make sense?
Yes.
That's what separation of church and state means. The state can't tell the church what it can and can't do, but they did in 2020, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
Close your church doors.
Mm.
You don't have any right to tell me that. Okay? That's what separation of church and state means. That does not mean that the Bible can't be read in a public school. That doesn't mean that prayer can't be held in a public school. All that means is that no specific church denomination can tell the state or make the state do what it wants. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I hope so. Hope and pray. Lord, you're in charge. Okay. Samuel Adams said, "Let statesmen and patriots unite their endeavors to renovate the age by educating their little boys and girls and leading them in the study and practice of the exalted virtues of the Christian system." Samuel Adams. Charles Carroll, a signer of the Declaration, said, "Without morals, a republic cannot subsist any length of time. They, therefore, who are decrying the Christian religion, whose morality is so sublime and pure, are undermining the solid foundation of morals, the best security for the duration of free governments." What Charles Carroll is telling you is, even if you have moral people that look moral, that are in public schools, that are teaching you morals, but if they're not teaching you the morals found in Scripture under the Christian system, then they're not for morality. That's what Charles Carroll said. William Ellery, signer of the Declaration, "However gradual may be the growth of Christian knowledge and moral reformation, yet unless it be begun, unless the seeds are planted, there can be no tree of knowledge and, of course, no fruit." He said, "The attempt to Christianize the heathen world and to produce peace on earth and goodwill towards men is humane, Christian, and sublime." You know what the world calls that today? Colonization. How dare you think that your Christian religion is better than ours? You need to respect our belief system. I respect you, but under my belief system, you're going to hell. What kind of a wicked person would I be if I didn't go and try to win you for Jesus Christ? But that's the belief system that people just don't understand today. You guys doing okay out there?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Benjamin Franklin. By the way, the two founders that most people know about in public schools are Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson. Why? Because they're supposed to be the most secular of the founders? Did you know that Benjamin Franklin, during one of the worst times... No, I'm sorry. It was right before the ratification of the Constitution in 1786. Before the Constitution was ratified, he was the one that got up in front of all these people and said, "Guys, we're debating back and forth. This isn't working. We've been doing this for years. Why don't we do what we did during the war? And let's get into praying and fasting to the Almighty God for His answer." That's what the least religious founding father did. And they did, and they got the answer, and the Constitution was ratified. Yeah. Benjamin Franklin said, "History will also afford frequent opportunities of showing the necessity of a public religion and the excellency of the Christian religion above all others, ancient or modern." My wife found this out the other day. You know who George Whitefield was? One of the great preachers? Benjamin Franklin was his friend. We all knew that. But we all think that Benjamin Franklin wasn't privy to religion and just made fun of him. But Benjamin Franklin actually printed tracts for George Whitefield. What kind of an atheist does that? John Jay, original Chief Justice, U.S. Supreme Court. "Only one adequate plan has ever appeared in the world, and that is the Christian dispensation." John Witherspoon, "The Christian religion is superior to every other." Oh my goodness. Patrick Henry, who said, "Give me liberty or give me death." Yeah. He said a quote that is so perfect for this situation. He basically said that it cannot be emphasized too often or too strongly that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians. Not on religion, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ, unquote. A bunch of irreligious founders we had, you know. Okay, lastly, I'll just read you what this thing here says. "An early House Judiciary Committee affirmed the founders' lack of pluralistic intent when it declared, quote, 'Christianity was the religion of the founders of the Republic, and they expected it to remain the religion of their descendants. They expected it. Did it happen? No. You know what happened? Too much outside influence. And folks, just so you know, that's why the borders are open right now, mm-hmm. is to try to completely destroy whatever is left of this blessed country.
That's right. Amen. That's true.
2 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 and 19, and we'll be done. I hope this wasn't boring to you. I love the United States of America.
Yes. 2 Peter what?
2 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 and 19. In fact, every time I go to the country jam in Alturas, they always close it with, God bless America. And every time it almost makes me queasy. Because I know that God can't. My song has been now, God save America. That's the song we need to start singing. Because without Him, we're going down. And I run the risk of offending people, but I will say that this election is the most important election we've ever had in our history.
Yes.
And in fact, if we don't vote for a certain Donald J. Trump, we may not have a country.
Right.
Hate me if you like. I don't care. But that's the truth.
Right.
While promising liberty, look at verse 18 and 19 of 2 Peter chapter 2. For when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lusts of the flesh, through much wantonness, those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. Now, this is talking about the condition of false prophets and teachers at the end of this age, where we're at. Okay? Now, look at this. Verse 19. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. You see, the liberalistic way of looking at life is, let's legalize all these things that are actually bringing about our destruction. Which means that they are the servants of corruption. They're focused on today, they're not focused on tomorrow. Listen, I want America, I want a country where Daniel can actually grow up and actually enjoy freedom. But I mean freedom as far as liberty is concerned. But if the majority rules, we won't have a country left. Democracies always devolve into socialistic governments. They always do. While promising liberty, they are serving corruption. They serve the need or even the want of the moment. Regardless of how that may affect the future, it doesn't matter. We have to think about here and now. That is the platform of the Democratic Party. And as a Republican, I have to have a long view, making decisions today that will make a sustainable, enjoyable, spiritually healthy tomorrow. Spiritually speaking, let's close it up. These spiritual leaders promise liberty in the form of escape from legalistic churches. Are you with me? I'm going to say that again. Spiritually speaking, these spiritual leaders promise liberty in the form of escape from legalistic churches. I've been there before. When I've gotten turned off by Independent Fundamental Baptist, all my family was there to rescue me. Oh, poor John, you were in the legalistic churches. They promised the people, hey, now you can listen to the music you want. You want. Who cares what Bible version you read? And you don't have to witness, you just need to be a good citizen and let the preacher do the work. Sit back, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we shall die. Only trouble is they are the servants of corruption. Paul said this, Christian, take heed that no one steal your crown. You have a crown to win, and you're going to lose it if you're hanging around in this camp. Spiritually speaking. But spiritually speaking, if you hang in here, and you fight here, then you will have a crown.
Yes.
You get a crown for labor for the Lord. These laid-back churches don't encourage you to work for him and therefore are stealing your crown because they are the servants of corruption. Christian, now is the time to awake out of sleep. Now is the time to speak up and serve the Lord. Now! I don't know if I can emphasize this enough to where it'll finally wake some of you up. But I'm going to guess here that obviously the world is going to hell, right?
Yeah.
We have here this morning, I think about 30 to 35 people. Am I right?
37.
37 people, again. 2 weeks in a row, 37 people. And yet, we only average between 7 and 10 people for Wednesday night prayer meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Christian, you have not because you ask not.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. It's good.
Well, I don't have the time to make it Wednesday night. Make the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Make the time. Listen, you only have such a short period of time to do what's right before it's too late.
That's right.
Kids, some of you in here, I know we're not having youth group this Thursday, but whatever's holding you back, make it to youth group the next Thursday. Mm-hmm. Make it. You be the difference. Don't be like your friends. Don't be like the people in the public schools. Be what God wants you to be.
Yes. 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 Yes.
The founding fathers didn't become that way because they were trying to be like everybody else. Out of the 54 people that signed the Declaration of Independence, do you realize that almost, I think it was over 30 of them had ministerial degrees? They were working. And you know the average lifespan of those founding fathers was 45? Benjamin Franklin was 70-something. He was an oddity. But anyways, Christian, all we have in our life is this. When we get to your grave, and you have your grave, you're going to have born, whatever that is, and then you have died. Whatever that is. We don't know. But all you have is this dash.
Yeah.
That's all you have, and it goes so stinking fast. I mean, I'm 41, and it is going faster and faster and faster. And those of you that are 70 and 80 years old in here are laughing at me right now because you think you don't know what fast is like yet. And I agree with you. That's fine. But man, it has. It's already July. It's going to be July tomorrow of 2024. Life is going fast.
Yeah.
And I have every head bowed and every eye closed, and as Brother Ray begins to play the music, I just want to ask you, where is your heart at today? You know, as the, I can't remember if it was Toby Keith or whoever, but they said, freedom don't come free. And let's just put that in the terms of liberty. Our liberty was bought and paid for with the blood of patriots. And most of them are just regular everyday farmers. But they took their muskets out there, they stood face to face with the redcoats, and they bled and died and suffered. Most of them had their homes burned up. Why? So you can just take your liberty for granted? So you can let it just die? The old phrase, the founders are rolling around in their graves, is probably very true. If there is somebody here today that doesn't know that they're going to heaven when they die, would you please raise your hand so I can pray for you today? Amen. I see your hand. Now, if you want to come forward during this time or after the service, I can take you back and we can tell you how to get saved and you can know ahead.
Yes.
These things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Don't leave today without knowing that you're going to heaven. For the rest of you, how is your heart? Are you ready to commit yourself more to the ways of liberty and the spiritual liberty that we have as Christians? To use it not for an occasion of the flesh, but to serve God and to love one another? If God is working on your heart today, why don't you come forward as the music plays? as people are continuing to pray, I'm just going to ask you a personal appeal as a pastor. If you can make it to Wednesday night prayer meeting at 5 o'clock, if you can, why don't you come? Why don't you come, please? We're a body of believers. We all need each other. We all need to hear each other pray. That's like the most precious thing in the world, is to hear each other pray. If God has worked on your heart in this message to at least consider it, please come to the front. Please pray right where you're at. And so, you know what? Whatever I've got going on at home for that 1 hour can wait. It can wait. Because God can't wait. By the way, we might as well get ready for July 24th, because that's a Wednesday night.
That's right.
We might as well get in the habit of coming here Wednesday night. What do you say?
Amen.
Okay. My country, tis of thee, 126, and we'll be dismissed. My country, tis of thee.
I almost forgot all these patriotic songs.
I was almost thinking of singing, "This land is your land," and then I realized it's not.
No. Well, it's Russia. Oh, China. Sorry.
Most of it's been sold to China.
Yeah,
and everywhere
that's right. Else, so. Yeah.
But my country, tis of thee. That's applicable. We'll do that.
Yeah.
Well, hear me out. Let's turn on. My country, tis of thee. 126, go ahead and stand, and we'll be ready to be dismissed right afterwards, okay? My country, tis of thee. Land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims' pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. My native country, be
service, Lord. Thank you for this day that you have given us, Lord, for the message that we've received, that we just keep it in our hearts and knowing what you want for our country, Lord, and what you say about our country, and what we should lie our hearts and our loyalty to, Lord, is to you. So please, Lord, on this week coming up, and remember our country's birthday, Lord, and our founders, Lord, about for our country, that we remember it was all for you, Lord. That we're just still worms in this world, and that you are the one that we count on, Lord, that we have to look up to the hills for our help. And Lord, please, just bless all that are here and all that are not, and to be with us, and for us to see each other again on Wednesday and Tuesday for men's Bible study, Lord. Just until that time, Lord, we thank you and everything. Amen.
Amen. You are dismissed. Thank you, everyone.